That was total luck.
All right, good evening and welcome to Winchester Academy's Summer 2021 series. My name is Tracy Barrett and I am a trustee of the Winchester Academy as well as the director of the Wapaka Historical Society. We'd like to take a moment to thank the City of Wapaka and our producer Josh Werner for providing the technology to bring this program to you from our usual location in the Wapaka Public Library's lower level meeting rooms where we're conducting a live test of the new AV equipment. We're anticipating a return to meeting here in the library for our fall series. Our last program of the summer series is in 2 weeks on Monday, August 2nd, when Wapaka native Julie Foote shares her recent experiences living and teaching in Myanmar. That program will be a hybrid.
It's not. It died again. Ah, batteries.
There we go. That sounds better, Josh. Thank you. Can I start over? All right. Good evening again. And welcome to Winchester Academy's Summer 2021 series. My name is Tracy Barrett, and I am a trustee of Winchester Academy, as well as the director of the Wapaka Historical Society. We'd like to take a moment to thank the City of Wapaka and our producer, Josh Werner, who just changed our battery, for providing the technology to bring this program to you from our usual location in the Wapaka Area Public Library's lower level meeting rooms, where we're conducting a live test of new AV equipment. We're anticipating return to meeting here in the library for our fall series. Our last program of the summer series is in 2 weeks, on Monday, August 2nd, when Wapaka native Julie Foote shares her recent experiences living and teaching in Myanmar. That program will be a hybrid with limited in-person seating in the Wapaka City Council chambers, together with virtual broadcasting. Tonight's program is co-sponsored by the Wapaka Historical Society and Winchester Academy. We have representatives of both boards with us here tonight in our studio audience. We will have a question and answer session following the presentation tonight. Questions may be submitted via the Facebook Live site or by telephone. The phone number is 715-942-9917. Our speakers tonight are Ken and Barb Wardius, lifelong residents of Milwaukee. They have traveled statewide and nationally pursuing their hobbies of lighthouse history and photography. Ken and Barb belong to several organizations dedicated to lighthouse preservation, including the Great Lakes Lighthouse Keepers Association, the Wisconsin Historical Society, the Wisconsin Maritime Museum at Manitowoc, and many more. They are authors of 4 lighthouse books, including Wisconsin Lighthouses, Cana Island Lighthouse, Wind Point Lighthouse, and North Point Milwaukee Lighthouse. We will be having a book sale and signing tomorrow morning at the Wapaka Historical Society's Holly Center location from 10 a.m. until 11 a.m., and that's at 321 South Main Street.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you, Tracy, and thank you, Ann. Thanks to the Academy. Thanks to the Historical Society for sponsoring us this evening. We're happy to be in Waupaca. We haven't been here for a number of years. We came in early this afternoon, went to Hartman Creek State Park, went to the train depot, Brainerd Park, just beautiful, beautiful town. Thank you for inviting us. What we're going to do in the time we're with you this evening is primarily discuss this book, Wisconsin's Lighthouses. There are 48 lighthouses in the state. We will not cover them all. We'd be here all evening. So, but we're going to give you a really good slice of what the state has to offer. Wisconsin ranks number 2 on the Great Lakes for the number of lighthouses. The state of Michigan has almost 3 times as many as Wisconsin. They have more Great Lakes. They have more shoreline. But we're number 2. We try a little harder. So if all this technology, thanks again to Josh for setting this up, if all this works, we'll have a good time tonight. Let's move forward. Oh, that's primarily for me, because I always forget to do that. We'll have this at the end of the program, too, but you can call us, you can text us, you can go to our website, you can go to Facebook. We'll have this information at the end of the program as well. Primarily what we'll cover tonight is this book. The other 3 books are individual books on 3 specific lighthouses. The first book covers all 48. We're going to start with a little bit of music. We'll talk about our daughter a little bit, too.
Let's take a trip around Wisconsin. When Ken and I first began researching in photography 20 plus years ago, we didn't realize there were 48 lighthouses in the state. So we did a couple of trips up to the Castle Islands. We came down the Bay of Green Bay, a little bit of Lake Winnebago, and of course all the way down to the Racine and Kenosha area. We just didn't know there were that many doggone lighthouses. But we'll start our tour today on Lake Superior, the largest freshwater lake in the world. 11 lighthouses are found here, and if you're a lighthouse enthusiast, this might be a place for you. Some of the most beautiful scenery in our state is also found here, and with the opening of the locks in 1855, this portion of Wisconsin was the very last to be settled.
The first lighthouse we'll discuss appropriately has Wisconsin in the title. This is the Wisconsin Point Light. It sits outside the city of Superior. It dates back to 1913, and as you can see from this photograph, not the easiest light to get all the way out on this breakwater. The breakwater actually is on a sandbar. Wisconsin Point is a sandbar. Across the channel is the state of Minnesota. Minnesota Point and Wisconsin Point is the largest freshwater sandbar in the entire world. The first light in this area, though, was in the state of Minnesota. It dates to 1858. It was on a point of sand that was not very well it would come and go with the tides over the years, so it didn't have a very long life. Just a few years ago, Barb and I walked this sand bar at Minnesota Point. This is all that is left that entire dwelling. So there was a need for a light, and then Wisconsin Point was built later on. This is our daughter, Sarah. She was a teenager when this photograph was taken. We were fortunate to do a lot of lighthouse travels as a family. Parents and grandparents in the audience probably realize that for a teenager, going to lighthouses with mom and dad, not at the top of the list of things you want to do. Sarah did smile here. We did some other touring. We were looking at colleges. We went to the Mall of America. But we, in all seriousness, we're very happy to do a lot of things together. Most lighthouses throughout the world were built in response to commerce. Some of them, yes, marked hazardous shoals, shallow areas of danger, but most of them were just alerting mariners to this is the city of Superior, this is the city of Green Bay. And each light was different as far as what characteristic it had. We'll talk about that a little bit later. But if you think back in the 1800s, the heyday of lighthouses is about a 100-year period in the Great Lakes area. The mid 1800s to by the mid 1900s, lighthouses were automated and relatively obsolete. Historically, hundreds and hundreds of schooners plied the Great Lakes, and the ships that you see in the picture here gave way to these modern super 1,000-foot carriers that still come and go from the Duluth Superior Harbor. Barb and I love history. We love to really dig into some of the little-known facts about individual lighthouses. Also have to put a plug in right here for historical societies. Public libraries were invaluable to the research that we did. Without them, our books would not have existed. One little tidbit we learned about Wisconsin Point. In November of 1975, the giant ore carrier Edmund Fitzgerald left the Duluth Superior Harbor, bound for the eastern Great Lakes. Little did the 29 men on board realize that this would be the last time they saw Wisconsin Point. Less than 2 days later, a terrible November storm sank the ship. Again, 29 men went to their grave.
So when we do our photography, we like to go at different times of the day to add interest to our work. This photo is more than 20 years old, but we got up a lot earlier, a lot easier then. We had one morning in Superior.
That's true.
It's like, now it's so early. Oh. But we had one morning to go. Sarah stayed back at the motel. She wasn't getting up. And this is before you had an app on your phone to tell you where the sunrise would be. So we set up on the beach, and I said, this isn't right. The sun's in the wrong place. Well, sure enough, we had to pack up our gear, run down the beach. We took this shot in about 20 seconds. The sun went behind the huge cloud bank. That was it. We were done. So we were really lucky. I'm as good as an app, right?
Barb is the best app, and I should have listened, but you know. We're going to move on now from the bottom left of the photograph to Superior. We're going to the northeast. This area is called the Apostle Islands National Lakeshore. That's a big, long title for a national park, islands and water. If you've ever been to the Bayfield area, it is gorgeous. Barb and I were just there, and Sarah, last week, revisiting some people, some friends, and, of course, some lighthouses. If you've ever been there, they have sea caves. It's picturesque every season of the year. We took some boat trips. You can do vacations, R&R, and certainly visit lighthouses. We rented what was called a water taxi. It's a for-hire boat. We visited all the Apostle Islands lights in one day. Don't do that.
20 years ago this was.
It's long. It was a long day. We learned a lot. We got a lot of photographs, but it was a very busy day.
Made it. This was our first stop on our whirlwind tour. This is the Sand Island Lighthouse, built here in 1881. It's built of locally quarried brownstone. On any given day, I would think it's probably one of my favorites or very close to the top. We learned the history of Sand Island comes to us courtesy of the Lewick family. This is Emmanuel Lewick. The next photo shows Mr. Lewick and his bride, 16-year-old Miss Emma. Well, It turns out lighthouse keeping was not for her. She lasted about 10 years on the island, packed up, headed for the mainland, never to be heard from again. But he did remarry Miss Oramil Buck, and they had several children at Sand Island. And we also learned that Mr. Lubick, in his spare time when he wasn't lighthouse keeping, was an amateur photographer. So someone took this picture of him, obviously, but the next photo is one of those fantastic archival photos that we love of Sand Island, taken by Mr. Lewick. Just a fantastic photo. Gingerbread House, Lighthouse, who wouldn't love that? One of the members in our audience tonight has been at Sand Island as a volunteer, so he can attest to its beauty. Love it there.
A number of lighthouses in the Apostles have volunteer docents from late spring through early fall. Prior to the coronavirus, Sand Island, Michigan Island, Outer Island, Raspberry Island were the main lighthouses that had folks stationed there. This lady was Mary Ann. We met her at Sand Island, told her of our dream of writing a book someday. We had no book. We actually met her several years after the book was published. We said, Mary Ann, we took your picture. We learned so much history in a brief time with Mary Ann. The National Park Service staff and volunteers were invaluable in our research. This was the first light we visited in our whirlwind day in the Apostles. Barb and I live in Milwaukee. The weather forecast on the Great Lakes, you never know if it's spot on or not. The forecast for this little tiny portion of Lake Superior was good. The next photograph shows what happened very quickly. The fog rolled into Sand Island. We were still going to Devil's Island, Outer Island, Michigan Island, Long Island. I think I missed one, Raspberry Island. The fog rolled in. We ran into a storm. And we should not have been on the lake that day.
Well, our captain of our water taxi said, don't worry, ma'am. The boat is double hulled. I'm not a sailor. I didn't know what that meant, but I figured it was a good thing. And it was. He kept us safe. We were kind of wet, but no worse for wear. We landed on Michigan Island. This was our last stop that day. Michigan Island has the oldest and the newest lighthouses on this particular lakeshore. This is the original light built here. It's a New England style light. 20 years ago, she needed some work. They've since renovated her. It's beautiful. The grounds have been redone to the period. Depending upon the whose records or stories you believe, they're not sure if they built this here by mistake or if the contractor, misread the map. At any rate, he had to build a second light at his expense on Long Island further to the south. That's a big oops, right? Oopsie, wrong place. No drones back here. This could have been taken from a hot air balloon or an airplane. Actually, it's taken from what's called the Widow's Walk or a parapet of this next lighthouse.
The structure Barb is describing is actually at the very top of the left-hand lighthouse that you see in this picture. There are two lighthouses on Michigan Island. She mentioned the oldest, 1857, and the newest, 1910. The lighthouse on the left-hand part of the screen actually was from the east coast of the U.S. It was a surplus lighthouse. They disassembled it, reassembled it on Michigan Island. The mariners were saying that the original was too short. Trees were starting to grow. For whatever reason, they decided they wanted a taller light instead of chopping down all the trees. From the water, this is what you see. Here you go again.
Hold on.
Go to plan B here. Try this. Never mind. From the water, you can see the difference in the heights of Michigan Island's lights. The short one on the right, and you can imagine over a century of time, would not have been tall enough. So the one on the left side is the second tallest light in Wisconsin at 110 feet. Our daughter Sarah sat at the base of this tower, 138 steps up the circular stairway. You see on the right-hand side a schematic of a cut-through of what it looks like. Many of the classic taller lights have these circular stairways. Not all of them, but most of them do. She sat at the bottom, said, no, thank you. Don't want to climb another lighthouse.
Done.
So on we went to Long Island. If you get to the top of a tall tower, though, it's like climbing a mountain. You got to get back down. This is a very short video of us descending the light at Michigan Island, the new Michigan Island light. And be forewarned, if you are at the bottom of the tower, people up at the top can hear every single word you
very
say
clearly.
Crystal clear, especially when they're saying, why don't those people that are up there come down? We skipped the little video. The National Park Service, every couple of years, they budget for significant improvements at many of the lights. A couple of years ago, they did Michigan. They've also done work on Raspberry, some work on Sand, some work on Outer. This is just a beautiful, beautiful restoration. There used to be a tram on Michigan Island, just gorgeous. The original Fresnel lens it's a 3.5 order. Order means size. It was taken out a number of years ago. This is the original lens that was in the old tower. It's at the National Park headquarters in Bayfield. Right now the building is semi-open. You can't tour any of the exhibits, but if you get a chance next year to go to Bayfield, you can stand right next to a piece of history. Prior to COVID, the Bayfield area, the Apostles area, has a lighthouse celebration beginning just before Labor Day in the fall. For about 3 weeks, they'll take tours. This year, they're still going with the boats around the islands. They're not landing on any islands, but these boat trips are really, really fun too. In a non-COVID year, you can land on Raspberry, you can land on Sand in Michigan, and they're beautiful tours.
We have to leave Lake Superior now, though, and go to Lake Winnebago. When we first began our research, we were surprised to find an inland lake with lighthouses. What gives with that? Turns out Lake Winnebago was very important for the logging industry. So, of course, if you're shipping logs or rolling logs down rivers, you need to have lighthouses to guide you. And even though the lake isn't all that deep, 22 feet at its deepest point, we've been told by people that recreational boat there still today say they still appreciate the lighthouses. And that's a good thing besides your GPS that's on your phone. If that doesn't work, at least you can see the lighthouse and know where you are. This is an artist's sketch of what the Menasha Lighthouse looked like. No longer stands, you can see from the dates. Very short-lived lighthouse. We've never been able to find a photo of it, so this will have to do. And now you're gonna have the fastest tour of Lake Winnebago that you'll ever have. There are four lighthouses, as I mentioned. There's Nina, which is in a lovely park. Glorified way station. You cannot climb the tower, but you can go to the base and look up at the light. Asylum Bay, the bridge that's in the photo is currently being rebuilt. A few good winters did the bridge in, so the DNR is rebuilding the bridge to get out to the Asylum Bay light. Rockwell is a privately owned light. This is someone's boathouse lighthouse. So if you're the owner, it's named after you. The Rockwells don't live there anymore, but the people that do invited us a few years ago to get in that close and see their lighthouse. So that was quite a treat, very ornamental. And Fond du Lac, though, is open to the public. It's a self-guided tour where you can just climb up and take a look from the bottom or the end of the lake. And if you really want to know more about Lake Winnebago, we recommend Steve Krieger's book. We don't get any money from this. We just think it's a great book.
That was the quickest tour ever. Lake Winnebago.
That's right.
We're going to journey now. The rest of the lights we're going to talk about are part of Lake Michigan. We're going to first discuss the very western shore. It's actually known as the Bay of Green Bay. Many lighthouses were out on islands historically in the Green Bay, the greater Green Bay area.
So take a look at this lovely archival photo. It doesn't look like this anymore. This is called the Green Island Light. It's 5 miles offshore from Marinette and Menominee. We learned that Frank Drew was the first head keeper here, and one of his logbook entries states, on this date, son Frank born under the light. Well, this is indeed his son Frank, who, as you can tell from the K for keeper on his lapels, was chief keeper at Green Island, just like his dad.
We've been fortunate, and I mentioned before, in addition to historical societies, public libraries, many descendants of lighthouse keepers we've been fortunate to get into contact with. The young lady on the left is Virginia Dresden and her sister June. This is from the 1930s on Green Island. This was really its heyday. That young lady came up to us after a talk in Milwaukee a number of years ago, 90 years old. She said, "I'm a lighthouse keeper's daughter. Would you like to talk to me about what life was like, you know, for children, for families at a lighthouse?" Sure, please.
Yes.
She actually lived just about 15 minutes from us in Milwaukee. In her apartment, she came out with a box of family photos, gave them to us, and said, "Take these, copy them, get them back to me whenever you want." And we sat down for the afternoon, and she talked about family life at a lighthouse. It was just priceless. Virginia was a sweet, sweet lady. Virginia and the Dresden family and others would not be too happy with what happened to Green Island. Ultimately, it was automated, abandoned, then later there was a fire, there was vandalism, and nature just kind of took its course after the 1960s or so. The photograph you see here, not even that much of the brickwork exists today. There's still a need for a modern light on... Thank you. There is still a need for a modern beacon, but this and these structures, sometimes people call them lights, lighthouses. They're not the traditional government lighthouse where people spent literally decades of their lives at. Not that they're not important.
Let the short people in here now. My turn. So now you know we don't own a boat, and if we need to get to an offshore location, we need to hire a boat or find someone that is the Commodore at the Green Bay Yacht Club who happens to have a 40-foot yacht and loves to take people out just for fun. So we met up with our new friend Merle, and he took us out for a 4-hour tour of Green Bay. Here I am working on the book.
No.
I really am. Can't
no,
you tell?
Not.
I really am working very hard on the book. It was wonderful. He just, take your time, do whatever you want. He took us everywhere, let us land wherever we wanted to. It was wonderful. But now we have to move along. Move along, please. Door County, one of our favorite places. And if any of you know the history of Door County, hundreds of shipwrecks here, all the rocky outcroppings, not to mention all the shoals that the mariners couldn't see. Today, it's a boater's paradise, but again, boaters still appreciate the lighthouses, especially if their GPS goes out or if it's a really dark and stormy night when they got to get in. And the Door Peninsula is just this lovely thumb-shaped piece of land that stretches out into Lake Michigan. There are 11 lighthouses here, the most of any county in the country. They have 2 lighthouse festivals here, a fall and a spring one. So if you're a lighthouse enthusiast, we used to say lighthouse nuts, but that scares people. So now we're enthusiasts. This is the place for you to go. And our first stop here will take us to the Old Bailey's Harbor Lighthouse, or the Birdcage style. Look at the lantern room on the top. It's very different. It's called a birdcage, and you can sure see why. We learned that Captain Justice Bailey took refuge here during a storm. This is Allenson Sweet, the owner of the shipping company. Captain Bailey said, "This is a great natural harbor. We could put a lighthouse here." They petitioned the government for money. No money ever came, so Mr. Sweet built this lighthouse and keeper's quarters at his own expense. There's some close-ups here of the birdcage lantern room. This is privately owned today. Owners have done a nice job of refurbishing the home, but we understand they're not interested in preserving the tower. And since it's privately held, it's very sad. It's still standing. We were up there last spring, and yeah, it was still standing, but oh, I don't know. It's kind of scary. Okay, so look at this one, another boat. This is from a few years ago, and Ken has waders, I don't. He gets to go over to the Lighthouse Island, and I don't get to go. But luckily for me, some fishermen came along and said, "Well, take Lars. Lars is this lovely red, we'll call it a boat, that we're standing in front of." And they said to me, "You get in." They said to Ken, "You pull." So he did.
Lars was actually more rusted than it was red.
It was bad.
There's an old movie called The African Queen with Humphrey Bogart and Katharine Hepburn. There's a scene in the movie where he's trudging through the jungle, pulling the boat.
Sure,
it didn't exactly look like that. But
not, Not exactly. There wasn't a lot of trudging going on, but the boat did leak.
It did leak.
So, you know, the first thing I said to him, oh, my God, the boat is leaking. And the first thing Ken said to me was, pick up the camera gear. Okay, I'm good. Fine. We learned when you land on an island lighthouse, the lighthouse is always at the opposite end of the island. This was no different. So there we are, tripods, camera gear, all kinds of stuff, walking along the shore. And there were a couple of gentlemen in a boat, and they waved. And, of course, we're friendly. We waved back, and they said, where are you going? We're going to the lighthouse. They said, that's really nice. You're trespassing. This is private property. Now, we had asked in Bailey's Harbor. We had asked at the library. No one either didn't tell us or simply didn't know it was privately owned. And, of course, they wanted to know what we wanted. We said, well, duh, a picture of your lighthouse. Take your picture and get off our island. Okay, clear enough. By the way, beware of the large dog that roams the grounds. Here he is. Thankfully, not large and not roaming. We left a business card, said we'd love to send you a print of your lovely home. We never heard from them. We have not landed on the island since, but we've been past it in a boat. Never again. Done.
We won't be invited back.
No, I don't think so.
I mentioned early in the program, most lighthouses were built in response to commerce to identify various towns and cities. Bailey's Harbor is one of those locations where there was an actual need, though, for specific beacons in that area because of treacherous shallows and shoals. So the old Bailey's light didn't function very well with keeping mariners safe, and it actually was decommissioned not that long after it was put into service. But in place of this old light, three other lighthouses in the greater Bailey's Harbor area were built, all of them built in 1869. If you've ever been to Bailey's Harbor, you may know of the Ridges Sanctuary. These are called the Bailey's Harbor Range Lights. They're on the grounds of the Ridges Sanctuary. This is a historic photo of two lighthouses. Range lights are a short lighthouse towards the shore, another taller lighthouse in back of it. Each of them has a light. This is what it looks like today. Very, very well kept. If you're a mariner out on Bailey's Harbor and the front lighthouse is to your right, you're off course to your right. You want to move to the left. If you move too far to the left, the beacon, the front beacon is to the left. What you want is those two beacons to be absolutely vertical with each other, one light above another light. This photograph is on, it's called On Range. Range lights on the Great Lakes were unique. Wisconsin has three sets of these, very, very different, but engineers back then figured that out. And this is the straight, safe line into the hazardous area of Bailey's Harbor. So there was a need for specific lights. The Ridges over the last several years has done remarkable restoration of both the front and the rear range lights. They're also working on the bottom right photo. It looks like a schoolhouse. They're working inside now to bring the building up to the early 1900s era for people to, and you can visit these and tour these. They're considered active aids to navigation, even with, as Barb mentioned, all the technology we have today. They're still lit every night. The original Bailey's light, though, was a fairly tall tower, so there was still a need for a tall, what's called a coastal light. And just a couple miles north of Bailey's Harbor at Cana Island, this lighthouse was built. This is the, just if you think of a lighthouse in your mind, you probably wouldn't be too far from Cana Island. 86 feet tall, again, 1869. It has the original French-made Fresnel lens in the tower. It's the oldest existing lens in the state of Wisconsin. The Coast Guard is taking lenses out of towers, putting them in historical societies and maritime centers. We are told that two lighthouses in Wisconsin will maintain their Fresnel lens, Devil's Island in the Apostles and Cana Island in Door County. This lens stands about as tall as Barb. It's about 5 feet tall. It's dozens and dozens of hand-polished glass prisms, and you don't have to be a physicist or a rocket scientist. What Fresnel lenses do is it takes all of the light from a light source in the middle of the lens that goes out in all kinds of directions. It bends it and it concentrates it and it shoots it out, in this case, over Lake Michigan. Fresnel lenses revolutionized lighthouses, not just in Wisconsin, but throughout the world. Mariners could see the beacons much brighter and many more miles out on the world's oceans and the seacoasts and the Great Lakes of the U.S. Cana Island actually is a brick tower. Cana Island gets a lot of severe weather, and a couple of decades after Cana Island was built, they actually enclosed it in the metal sheeting that you see here in the 1930s. The Door County Maritime Museum and the County of Door take care of Cana Island. It's open spring through fall, depending on Mother Nature and the lake level of Lake Michigan. Over the last several years, the Maritime Museum and the county has embarked on a multi-year, multi-million dollar restoration of the entire complex at Cana. They built the parking lot, they did work on the tower. There was an old barn historically from the early 1900s that was renovated. Historically, this barn would have had farm animals, cows, chickens. They had fruit trees, they had gardens. They were somewhat self-sufficient in addition from all the things that the federal government gave them. Many lighthouses also have a fuel building. The building in the right is a privy. It's a fancy name for an outhouse. They renovated that. Probably not a good thing to talk about after supper, but actually the pit of a outhouse actually contains a lot of great historical information, artifacts, things that people would just back then just throw out. And the privy at Cana Island is a two-seater. The deluxe.
Absolutely.
No privacy, no social distancing. About 10 years ago, Cana Island, to get to it, was completely dry. The lake level has changed a lot over the last 5+ years. A few years ago, it was 3, 4, 5 inches deep. The Maritime Museum would ferry people back and forth with a tractor and a wagon. 2 years ago, the lake level was higher. They got a bigger wagon, a bigger tractor. When the winds come around the island, they meet at what's called the causeway there. And last year, when Lake Michigan was at a maximum, they closed Cana Island many days because you just couldn't get to it even with the machinery that they had. These are just some of the photos of on a not flat day, you might not be visiting Cana. This new big tractor, it was right up to the engine. There's also a visitor center that was built last year on Cana Island, just a nice place to review history. There's a gift shop there. If you get a chance, Cana Island is the most visited lighthouse in the state on a regular year. Prior to COVID, tens of thousands of people go to Cana Island. Barb and I, this is where our interest in lighthouses really started 30+ years ago. We try to get there every time we go to Door County. This morning was a keeper. This is the photograph from the cover of our book. Many times we got up for sunrise and it was gray and ugly and we threw those photos away. We love these old archival photos. Again, could be from a historical society, public library. This is Conrad Stram. He was only a keeper at Cana Island about 5 years, but he was in the lighthouse service over 40. That was quite common, actually. So we were always wanted to do a separate book on Cana Island. We're going to quickly go down the coastline of the rest of the state of Wisconsin down to the state line. Every single city along the way has a lighthouse. In fact, several of them have more than one.
This is called the Rawley Point Lighthouse. It stands in Point Beach State Forest. This is the tallest light in Wisconsin at 111 feet, so she beats the new Michigan Tower by all of 1 foot. But But if you look closely at this photo, attached to the keeper's quarters is something that looks like a lighthouse tower. That's the original light at this location from 1874. Mariners were complaining, as in many locations, we can't see the light. So we're told they chopped it off, re-roofed it, and it became part of the keeper's round living room. What you do with your sofa, but they said they used every inch of available space, so I believe it.
I don't know. This tower at Rawley Point actually came from the Chicago River. There was a new lighthouse that was being erected there, and they disassembled it, reassembled it at Rawley Point, giving it this just gorgeous look. The style of this light is called an erector style. I had an erector set as a kid with all kinds of, you know, supports and struts. It makes for really nice geometry, really neat angles for photos. Most importantly, it's a very strong concept of building the light, supporting the beacon at the top and also the central column where the circular stairway is. Rawley Point is a rest and relaxation place for active and retired military personnel. They put in for various days or weeks at a time. The public cannot get into Rawley Point. You can go to Point Beach and take photographs from some of the trails near the light. We were fortunate that a retired Marine friend of ours had the key for the weekend at Rawley Point. We've been in the tower one time and one time only. This was one of the more powerful lights on the Great Lakes. In its heyday, with a third-order lens, the beacon shone on a clear night over 20 miles. This lady is always following me at Lighthouse. I don't know.
She's always got a camera or something. What is her deal? Let's move along here now. Come on, advance that slide. Thank you. So we can't do a lighthouse program without talking about our hometown of Milwaukee. And there are actually three lighthouses that were called or are known as Milwaukee North Point. This is the original location, built, it turns out, a little too close to the bluff in 1855. Erosion became a problem early on. It only took them, though, 30 years to build a new lighthouse a bit further inland, way away from that bluff, a lovely 40-foot-tall metal tower with a huge keeper's quarters. In the foreground are the famous Lake Park Milwaukee Lion Bridges. The park was designed by Frederick Law Olmsted, and he designed the park around the lighthouse. Mariners are complaining, we can't see the light, the trees are growing. Look at this photo, this is very rare. It shows the temporary beacon in the middle before they put a new base on the light and made her just a little bit taller. The bluff she sits on is very tall, so with the light being extended as it is, it's more than 150 feet above the lake. You can clearly see the seam where they join those two bases. The photo dates to about 1915 based on the ages of the cars in the picture. Today, though, there are no cars allowed on the Lion Bridge, just bicycles or foot traffic. And the next photo is from the 1960s when the Coast Guard used the building for housing. And we can't talk about Milwaukee without talking about Georgia Stebbins, a woman lighthouse keeper. They were not that common. Many women were assistants, maybe in name only. Some received pay, you know it, and some didn't. They had to know the job anyway. But Miss Georgia took care of North Point. She came from New York State at the advice of her doctor. Her health wasn't good. She came here to the original light to help her dad, whose health wasn't good either. Her doctor in New York said, go to Milwaukee. The fresh lake breezes will do you good. Apparently they did. She stayed on as head keeper for 30 years in Milwaukee. Amazing, just amazing. And we have a couple of artist sketches of what we think Miss George would look like tending her light. And of course, looking over her complex at Milwaukee North Point.
After a number of years, the Coast Guard removed themselves from the complex here at North Point. The lens was taken out of the tower, and really, Miss Georgia and others would not have been happy with what happened to North Point. It was boarded up eventually. Animals got inside both the tower and the house. It was a mess. There was a small group that got together and formed a small friends group about 30 years ago now, and it was their dream to renovate Milwaukee North Point back to its heyday. They opened up the tower. This photograph is after they removed. They said there was about a foot and a half. They called it debris. There were birds, animals, other things living in the, it was a mess. This is after it was cleaned up. Rusty pipes, paint that's chipping, all of the paint was lead-based paint, so they had their work cut out for them. The shroud you see in the picture covering the tower, in addition to lead paint in the tower itself, there was lead paint in the ground, so there was a lot of environmental abatement that was necessary for Milwaukee North Point. The keeper's quarters was a very large one. They actually totally reconfigured it and renovated it. This is Milwaukee North Point today. It's called the Jewel of Lake Park for a very good reason. If you'd have seen this place 30 years ago, you thought these people are never going to be able to accomplish this. The museum, it's a museum now. Other activities are taking place at Milwaukee North Point. Last year it was closed the entire year for COVID, but it reopened in July. It's a great museum. You can climb the tower if you like. Just a beautiful place. I think Miss Georgia would be much happier with what happened at Milwaukee North Point. So our hometown light, we had to write another book. We've covered a lot of lighthouses. Some of them we haven't touched on. Lighthouses, the status of them have changed a lot in the last, particularly last 2 to 3 decades. Historical societies and other friends groups have become involved with preserving many of them. Some of them have really good happy endings, some not so much. We're going to briefly go through a number of them that are in the state of flux. If you're interested in purchasing a lighthouse, the federal government would actually like you to do that. Buyer, beware. There's a couple of Green Bay out in the harbor lights available for sale. This is the Peshtigo Reef Light. Sits off the city of Peshtigo. It's a very shallow area. There was a light ship out here historically. There's a twin a little bit north in the bay, the Green Bay Entrance Light. Both of these offshore lights are for sale. And as you can imagine, if you're a land light versus a light that's have to get access to via boat, you have a whole nother set of circumstances, especially drinking water, disposal of sewage. You don't want to know what they did years ago with both of those. Two other lights in Green Bay, the Grassy Island Range lights. These were two lights vertical of each other. The southern end of Green Bay is very, the water depth is very, it's not predictable a lot of times, so range lights were built. The Coast Guard was actually going to demolish these on Grassy Island and burn them. A couple of gentlemen from the Green Bay Yacht Club thought these were very important historic lights for Green Bay as well as De Pere, and they thought a better end was necessary for them. At their own expense, these two gentlemen and others from the greater Green Bay area had them towed to the Yacht Club on a kind of a makeshift wharf about 20 years ago. The gentleman on the left is Dave Nelson. He passed away a couple of years ago. He donated over $2 million just to restore this area of the wharf and the lighthouses. Next to him is Merle. He's the captain of the boat that we took out on Green Bay. This is what the Grassy Island range lights look like today. There's a welcome center. The two range lights are just gorgeous, and without, in this case, mostly private help, these two lights would not have existed. Another couple lights in Door County. This is the Red Sturgeon Bay Pier Light. This is right next to the Coast Guard complex that has a tall white tower on its property. This was purchased by an individual. We have heard nothing as to what their plans are for the light. The Coast Guard still takes care of the beacon. It's their responsibility. But individuals or groups can buy the rest of the lights and do what they will. Generally, the government would love you to renovate it. They would love you to open it up to the public. Sometimes that's possible. Most times it's very expensive. Two other lights in Door County. This is Plum Island. It's in the Death's Door Strait. A couple miles east is Pilot Island. Pilot Island is a bird sanctuary. Barb and I love birds. Hundreds of gulls, hundreds of cormorants have decimated Pilot Island. It is a mass of about 2 feet of bird droppings. Historic lighthouses and bird sanctuaries generally don't get along too well. The building in the foreground here is the fog signal at Pilot Island. It is actually collapsing upon itself. It was one of the loudest fog signals on the entire Great Lakes. It is not likely to survive. This is Pilot Island in its heyday around 1910. There is a Friends group, Friends of Plum and Pilot Island, in conjunction with the federal government. They've been doing some, there's also a life-saving station on Plum Island. They've been doing a lot of work renovating that. Since Pilot Island is kind of off limits to the public and is a bird sanctuary, like I said, chances are Pilot will not survive. But the Friends of Plum and Pilot, they don't give up.
You have to be tough and tenacious. This is the Manitowoc Breakwater Light, and a gentleman, an individual from New York, purchased this light about 10 years ago. And a few summers ago, we heard just by pure luck that he had the lighthouse painted inside and outside, and it was open for tours for 1 day. And if you look at the crowds lining the pier waiting to get in, it was a big deal. We had the chance to meet him, and he just didn't understand that people were so excited. So they're hoping they'll open it up again this summer, maybe 1 or 2 days, because the interest is definitely there. She has a twin in our harbor of Milwaukee with the Dennis Sullivan in the foreground. A nonprofit group bought this light. The pier that light is on, though, is not continuous, so they have to figure out how to get out there. They don't even have a boat yet. But with other renovations, never say never, they might make it work. Last we heard, they're still working on funding. Always funding. The Kenosha Pierhead Light. There's an artist in residence here on the weekends, and if he's home, the door is open and you're welcome to come in and climb. There's a twin in the Milwaukee Harbor land-based light that is for sale. So if you're looking for a lighthouse, this is on land. It's not far. There's a parking lot right nearby. So this might be the one that you want to purchase. Maybe not, but it's nearby at least. And if you need to paint your lighthouse, this is what you do. You shroud it, again, to keep all that paint from Lake Michigan. This is Algoma. Many years ago, it was red. Before the paint job, it was pink. But after they did all their wonderful work, beautiful gleaming red lighthouse again with the catwalk. Very nice job. And the last one we'll talk about is the Kewaunee Pierhead Light. The city of Kewaunee took over the care of this light a couple of years ago. They've put in new windows, made her watertight, and now they're going to start working on the inside. And as you can tell, needs a little bit of work, but they are making progress. They've taken the lens out of this light and out of the Algoma Tower. This is how it's done. The smaller lights, they can just lower right down the hatch. The larger ones, they have to actually disassemble. The Algoma light is in the Milwaukee North Point Museum, and the one from Kewaunee sits in their History Center in a lovely, lovely display. And this is what replaces those lights, a very efficient, not lovely, but efficient, little pancake lighthouse with LED lights. And the next one, I believe, is the Kewaunee light in its new receptacle at the Kewaunee History Center. It's lovely. But if you have problems and you go to Kewaunee for sunrise, you forget all about them, and this is what you get. It's great.
Lighthouse renovation, as you can imagine, is a time, treasure, talent, they say, especially the treasure part is very expensive.
Open your wallet.
Sometimes we're asked, what's your favorite lighthouse in the state? Boy, that's a real tough question to answer. What we've done here briefly is put together a number that are kind of our favorites, but they're also open to the public. Of the 48 lights in the state, less than half of them are open to the public. And less than half of those are in any kind of state of restoration. So if you get to go to some of these that are restored and are really in tip-top shape, it's a big deal. This is the old Port Washington lighthouse in the city of Port Washington up on what's called St. Mary's Hill. It's open on weekends now, past COVID. It's restored wonderfully to period furniture in the early 1900s. Just a great, great job. 30 years ago, this place was a mess. Wind Point, north of Racine, there's a caretaker couple that lives there. The Coast Guard still takes care of the light. And the village of Wind Point uses a lot of the keeper's quarters for their municipal services. It's like a park-like setting. One Sunday a month in the summer, the village of Wind Point opens it up to the public. You can climb the tower if you like. It's the third tallest in the state. Cana Island in Door County, we mentioned it. If you go to Door County, it's the most highly recommended spot to go. A self-guided tour in Fond du Lac in Lakeside Park. You can climb the stairs and look over the marina at Fond du Lac. It's just gorgeous. We did not talk about this lighthouse also in Door County. This is Eagle Bluff. It's in Peninsula State Park between Fish Creek and Ephraim. The state DNR and the Door County Historical Society run this light. This is another one of those just gems. Restored to the early 1900s with period furniture. There's volunteer docents. The Historical Society just does a wonderful job. The Duclan family lived here historically. William and Julia Duclan raised 7 boys at the lighthouse. This was a nice facility, but 9 people at a lighthouse. The boys were always getting into mischief. When they restored the light, they took the layers of paint off inside. I think they counted 70 layers of paint. And the youngest Duclan boy, Walter, was 90 when he came back to the lighthouse. They asked him about that, and he said his parents gave them a paintbrush whenever they got into trouble. And a little gleam in his eye said, we got into
a lot
of trouble. That was Eagle Bluff. Sand Island, we mentioned in the Apostles. Beautiful brownstone, highly recommended. We did not touch on Raspberry Island, the National Park Service at any of the lights in the Apostles typically would have people staffed. They will next year again after COVID now, but Raspberry is renovated. It's just beautiful. And last but not least is our hometown of Milwaukee, North Point, made into a museum. We have talked a lot. It's time to finish the program with some of our favorite photos set to music. After that, we'd like to have the audience, both in person and virtually, ask some questions. So sit back and enjoy the last few minutes of Wisconsin's lighthouses. You were Coast Guard on the Milwaukee Breakwater, and that weather came up. You were staying there for a bit. you're ever on a pier and you see these people coming and you don't want to talk about lighthouses, go the other way. Thank you for coming tonight, everybody. I want to repeat the phone number for those that might want to call in. Questions on the phone, 715-942-9917. Any questions here, the live audience, or Ann, do you have anything yet online? In the back. Oh, thank you. Thank you so much.
Discussing the Southport Lighthouse that is also in Kenosha and asking about lighting the light for a special occasion. And yes, you can still do that. They do charge a fee. I don't know what it is any longer, but they would put a little piece in the newspaper that tonight's lighting is in honor of so-and-so or somebody's anniversary. What a great way to raise money for the light. They've done so much work there and it's not cheap. So they raise funds that way. Yes. Great.
The Kenosha Southport Light is just up the hill from the Pier Light. It's associated with the Kenosha History Center. Years ago, we met some people that were restoring it, and 30-plus years ago, too, it was in sad shape. Yeah. So to see it what it is today and to have an opportunity, as the gentleman mentioned, about lighting it for some special occasion, it's not a unique idea, but it's they really gave that some thought. It's a really nice idea. This is Algoma. This is a sunrise. A number of years ago, we did more sunrises than we do nowadays. But I kind of joked about it at Cana Island. We've been to various places with lighthouses for sunrise, and you never know what the weather's going to do. This particular morning in Algoma, the sun just made the sky orange just for a few minutes. Many times we've gone to some of these early locations and the sky is gray. It doesn't pop any color, and you never know, but we've been fortunate a number of times, primarily sunrises, that have the opportunity for some of those just once-in-a-lifetime colors.
That's the problem with the sunrises. They're so early. Like, oh my gosh.
But some of the photographs we've shown, most of the color all the color photographs are our own. We've been to some locations one time where we know we had some help because it was just spectacular. That rainbow that I just passed by, Milwaukee North Point, we were at the Milwaukee Lakefront. We usually carry a camera with us. A storm had just passed. We were driving through Lake Park, and here is this rainbow ending right at the lighthouse. The sunrise that Barb had talked about at Lake Superior, Wisconsin Point, was one morning. It was behind that cloud bank in less than a minute.
Yes, sir.
Go ahead.
Gentleman is asking about Pottawatomie Lighthouse, which is on Rock Island off of Door County. That one also has been renovated. We were there 30 years ago, and of course, like any lighthouse that's been ignored, rough shape. And we walked over with the Friends group that had just formed, and they had the key And they invited us in. I'll go if it's ragtag or not. You know. And it was bad. And they just told us all these grandiose plans they had. And you just want to go, yeah, that's really nice. And they made it work. It's renovated now. They have docents there that stay for a week for free. But your pay is taking people through and tours and keeping the lighthouse clean. They have, yes, they have a Fresnel lens in there. It's a plastic acrylic lens, so it's used for education. But it looks just like what it would have looked like historically. Wonderful job. Wonderful.
Put another plug in for Door County has a lighthouse festival in the spring in June and in the fall. Boat trips to island lighthouses, Pottawatomie, you have to get there by boat. They also do some land lights. I mentioned before the Apostle Islands has a celebration in the fall before and after Labor Day. Those are probably the two best areas for lighthouse festivals, celebrations, whatever they call them. But many of these lights, Pottawatomie, some of the ones in the Apostle Islands, even more locally, Southport and Kenosha, Milwaukee. If you would have seen many of them 30 years ago, you would never believe what could be improved. Unfortunately, there are some counterparts to that where Pilot Island in Door County is doomed. And quite frankly, it takes a lot of resources, a lot of time, a lot of money to even just restore some of these to a minimum point. So it's it takes volunteers. It takes a lot of hard work. Lighthouse restoration is not a cheap business, but we feel historically it's a necessary thing in many cases. Question, Ann. The person's asking about the red lighthouse in Milwaukee. That would be the Milwaukee Pier Light. We'll, oh, you know, it's back. This is the Milwaukee Breakwater Light. There's three lighthouses in Milwaukee, one in North Point, Lake Park, it's called North Point. There's a Breakwater Lighthouse out in the harbor, and there's also a land light, the red Pier Light. It is currently for sale by the federal government. Come on. A lot of times there's no set. Here, click this one. Just keep clicking it until. The price is set generally by the government. The price is not, starting price is never the same. It also depends on what kind of shape it's in, how accessible it is, whether it's likely a lot of people will be interested or nobody will be interested. Just keep flicking. I don't know this is the Milwaukee Pier Light. That's great. It is a red pier light. This style of lighthouse, by the way, is very common on the Great Lakes. There's one in Kenosha we mentioned. There's several on Lower Michigan. This style of pier light was used quite a bit by the federal government. It's about 65 feet tall, not too tall, not too short, generally out on wooden or cement piers.
Talk about the cost, how that works or doesn't work.
The government sets a minimum bid, and depending on how many people bid on it, it may go up. If nobody bids on it, the minimum bid would get it. But they determine that from a variety of factors. If the process of acquiring a lighthouse, as you can imagine, is a lot of bureaucracy, a lot of red tape. This lighthouse has been on the market for at least 3 or 4 years. We know of one group that is interested in it. And granted, COVID kind of took a year out of everybody's life and, you know, doing things like this. The government had more important things to do last year than to sell excess property lighthouses. But that process is not an easy, quick process. Depending on the starting price, some lighthouses have gone for several hundreds of thousands of dollars, some as low as a couple thousand dollars. So it's through multiple agencies, too, of the federal government.
Lots of letters, lots of alphabet letters.
Yeah, a lot of layers of of that, but yeah. If you're serious about it, it's a long, expensive process.
Kathleen Ernst's book, I believe I've read that, and it's fairly accurate from what I can recall. I've read that book, but it's been a number of years. I always like to think that some authors take a little bit of poetic license, but for the most part, a lot of the things, as I recall, and I hope I'm right, seem to be, at least historically, pretty accurate, the way she described what life was like on an island location. That was tough. These landlights weren't so bad, but if you were on an island location, you had to be self-sufficient. There's no doubt about it. Yeah.
That lighthouse in particular, there's several books. We knew a friend that did a novel, a murder mystery, Murder at the Pottawatomie Light, which was fiction.
It's totally
fiction, but a lot of the background information about, you know, mariners back then was very accurate.
Yeah.
Hope that helped it a little bit.
Yeah. Go ahead.
No, you and about half the world. It's a French word. The gentleman, the French physicist that invented that lens, Augustin Jean Fresnel, it's spelled F-R-E-S-N-E-L. It's pronounced Fresnel. We've heard Fresnel. The accepted pronunciation, French pronunciation, is Fresnel. Forget about the S, but you and everybody else have. We know people that are much more knowledgeable about lighthouses than us that do that sometimes. But it's a French made. Augustin Jean Fresnel, by the way, invented this lens. He actually passed away before it became widely used throughout the world. And the United States was very slow in adopting the lens. Mariners were clamoring for better beacons, more powerful lights, and the federal government, even back in the 1700s, was a very slow-moving process. They eventually did adopt those lens, but they revolutionized lighthouses throughout the world. Yep. That technology is still used today in car lights, railroads, as you mentioned, other technologies still today, over 200 years after it was invented.
Question is asking about if there are still lighthouse keepers in the lighthouse. There are no lighthouse keepers. You may have volunteers or families that stay for a week to help out. Everything is automated. So there are no real keepers. The Boston Harbor Light actually had a keeper up until I think a few years ago, just kind of for ceremonial purposes. But he was a federal employee and I think the money ran out. So there are no lighthouse keepers. Long.
When the United States was founded, the first lighthouse was in Boston Harbor. There was a need for maritime safety as the East Coast developed, and then as the European migration moved westward, there was a need for lighthouses. It was under the federal government's rules and regulations. Fast forward, 1939, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, they merged the Coast Guard with, it was the Lighthouse Service, it was the Lighthouse, it was a couple other
establishment.
It was under different wings of the federal government. In 1939, it became part of the Coast Guard. Really, by that time, the late 1930s into the early 1940s, most U.S. lighthouses were in some state of automation, and the keepers, the human presence, was slowly dwindling. The Coast Guard still maintains many of the beacons, although almost all of them are automated. They have sensors for, you know, when the sun comes up and goes down to turn the lights on and off. If they visit the lights once or twice a year, that's a lot. Very little maintenance is done, although most of the automatic stuff is quite dependable. Most of the lenses have been taken out of lights in museums and what have you, replaced by very efficient LED lights. They use a lot less. So there's not the need for the human presence anymore, but really from about 1940 or so, there are some examples of people still being at lights, but the century of U.S. lighthouses was really around 1850 to 1950, a little bit more or less than that, but you know, they're all automated. Yes?
The question is asking about historical saving these lighthouses. In the 1960s, it seems that people began to appreciate architecture and lighthouses and history more than they did beforehand, and all of a sudden it became the thing to save old train depots, old hotels, old buildings, and lighthouses. So we are fortunate at least that the lighthouses are still standing and a lot of them can be saved. Yeah. What were you?
There's a couple of examples. There was a lighthouse in the Racine Harbor called the Racine Reef Light. It was demolished in 1961, and that's right around the era that kind of we're talking about here. This was a one-of-a-kind Victorian style, just a gorgeous lighthouse. People in Racine today still say, if we would have been a little more forward-thinking to preserve the one-of-a-kind, they could have done tours, they could have done historical, you know, interpretation. It's just a shame, but that era, many of the lights at that time too had been mothballed and, you know, boarded up for several decades, and anybody that owns a house or a property, if you don't maintain them pretty routinely, and day to day, lighthouse keepers and their families were always cleaning, they were always doing something to keep the light working well and to be looking good. That was their job, and eventually that diminished and many fell into disrepair. Some were demolished, and thankfully some of them were saved. Yes. The question is, in the process of selling lighthouses, does the federal government want you to have some resources to hopefully, you know, maintain the light or to improve it? They do, although quite honestly, we can tell you of examples of groups that have attained a lighthouse, not to knock it down or just keep the land, but did not realize the undertaking they were starting. And I won't name the light, but there's a light that has been in the hands of a nonprofit group for over 7 years. They have done absolutely nothing. They cannot get the wheels turning on financing. And it's difficult. There are success stories where, you know, a friends group where that will start out slow and you don't think they're gonna, but little by little, some offshore lights. It's not impossible, but it's quite a task. Great question.
This lady has a question over here.
Yes.
Sure. The question is, what did they do before the Fresnel lenses? Like, what were the fuels used? Because by the time they had Fresnel lenses, it was kerosene. So that's a dangerous thing, but before that they would use things like whale oil, which had to be kept warm, so you're constantly going back and forth with whale oil. There was lard, again, lard, and the whale oil and the lard would smoke when it burned. So every day they were polishing all those different prisms, and they had to keep the wick trimmed just so that it wouldn't smoke, even though it would. Then there was kerosene that was so flammable that they had the separate little oil house buildings so that the lighthouse itself wouldn't blow up. It was just amazing the work that these people did, because you were up all night, and then during the day you were doing the cleaning that you caused during the night. I don't know when they slept. It amazes me what they did.
And prior to the Fresnel lens too, some of the oil burners were very, very small, very inefficient. They had some were like a silver mirror that would help project the light, but the Fresnel lens really, really changed that. But prior to that, many of the lights, some of the apparatus was pretty crude is a good word. I was going to say primitive, but very basic. A lot of challenges with the technology working every night like it's supposed to, and that was the light keeper's job. Many times they stayed up many hours. There's a story about the Wind Point Fresnel. This is Fresnel lens technology. A third order, about this tall. Some lights were a certain color. Some blinked. Some didn't. They all had a separate characteristic, a distinctive. You could tell Milwaukee from Chicago, from Kenosha, Racine. But the apparatus at Wind Point, when it revolved, and it flashed every certain amount of time. The first few, they started the lighthouse in the winter. The first few nights, it was frigid. The light would not rotate. And the lighthouse keeper and his son rotated the light by hand for about a week. Talk about dedication. A lot has been said about lighthouse keepers. They were very dependable. Thousands of mariners depended on them doing their job day in and day out. Very, very hardworking folks. Did I see another hand? Okay. All right. Thanks. Thank you.
Thank you.